Thank you. I'm delighted to see so many people here tonight, because I'm really eager to tell these stories that I don't get to tell very often. So for those of you who aren't familiar with storytelling, I'm sure there's some of you who haven't been to a storytelling program before. I just want to tell you that in our lives today, we are bombarded with images from the television, from movies. And so to me, the gift of storytelling is that I get to tell you the stories, but you get to choose what images go into your head. Because the listening to storytelling is not a passive act. It's active. It's whatever you choose to put in your own heads. So I hope you get lots of really cool images tonight. I'm going to tell you some stories that are in the grim variety, and some that have humor in them, and some that are true. When I first heard the first story that I'm going to tell you about, the Maco Light, I went right to my friend Gail, because she was born and raised in North Carolina, not very far from Maco. Maco's about 15 miles northwest of Wilmington, North Carolina. And I said, Gail, when you were growing up, did you hear that urban legend about the Maco Light, Joe Baldwin's light? She said, ho, that is no urban legend. That is true. She said when she was growing up, of course she heard that story. And when she was in high school, she and her friends would go to the railroad tracks at Maco and see if they would be the lucky ones to see the light. She never saw it, but she knew people who did. I came across a number of different versions of Joe Baldwin and the Maco Light. One was that Joe Baldwin was a conductor on the trains in 1867. And his train was stopped in Maco when he realized that his caboose had come uncoupled from the rest of the train. Because this was back in the days when trains were more primitive than now. They were wood burning, and they were coupled together with a series of links and pins. And somehow it had come apart. As conductor, it was his job to fix it. So he did what he knew to do. He held his lantern in one hand, and he stepped in between the two cars and tried to put the links and the pins back together to couple the cars. But the caboose shifted and rocked and smashed against the back of the train, and Joe Baldwin was decapitated. The more common story, version of the same story that I've read and heard since then, was also Joe Baldwin in the train, 1867, but in this other version, his train was moving. He was in the caboose on this moving train when suddenly he realized that the rhythm of that caboose had changed and it was not right. So he went to check out, and sure enough, the caboose had come uncoupled from the rest of the train. The whole train was barreling down the tracks, but the caboose was slowing down. Joe Baldwin knew that another train was coming down the tracks, and it was going to crash into that caboose. It would be a terrible accident if he didn't do something about it. So he got his lantern, he stood on the back of the caboose, and he waved that lantern over the tracks and out past the swamp, over the tracks and out past the swamp. And he saw the light of that caboose, or the new oncoming train coming toward him. But he kept on waving, trying to get their attention. There were spectators who said they watched, and that even though that train was barreling in on him, Joe Baldwin did not falter. He just stayed on that caboose, and the train came closer and closer and crashed into the caboose. And Joe Baldwin was decapitated. Shortly after that, people started seeing a light over the tracks. It would wave over the tracks and out over the swamp, over the tracks and out over the swamp. And they decided that what it was that Joe Baldwin had been buried, but they had never found his head. They figured it probably had catapulted over into the swamp. That's why they couldn't find it. So they figured here he was, his body was coming back with the lantern searching for his head. A few years after that, there were a few people, not so many, but a few people who saw a second light. This first light would be coming down the tracks in this direction, and the second light would be coming down the tracks in this direction. They'd move toward each other for a bit, but then they'd back off, and they never met. And folks said that second light was Joe Baldwin's head looking for his body. Well, now, in 1889, President Grover Cleveland's presidential train stopped in Maco. He observed what was going on, and then he asked the engineer, he said, "I don't understand. Wherever else I go in the country, the trains are signaled with one lantern. Why is it that here in Maco, your conductors use two lanterns?" And the engineer said, "Oh, that's because of Joe Baldwin's light. Because Joe Baldwin's light is one single lantern over the tracks out over the swamp. And we're afraid that oncoming trains, if they see one lantern, will think, oh, that's just Joe Baldwin's train or Joe Baldwin's lantern, and they'll ignore it. So we use two lanterns to let them know it's the real thing." Needless to say, Grover Cleveland went right back to Washington and told the story. Not very long after that, Washington sent scientific investigators to check it out, because of course they had to have another explanation. It couldn't be a ghost light. They stayed for weeks in Maco. They never saw the light. But while they were there, they checked out all kinds of possibilities. They eliminated the possibility of a jack-o'-lantern. Then they thought perhaps it was swamp gas. But if it was swamp gas, then why weren't they seeing it? And then they thought, headlights from cars. But people saw Joe Baldwin's light right after the accident in 1867. 20 years before there were cars, couldn't be that it was headlights. And so the investigators went back to Washington and gave it up. But if you want to go check it out for yourselves, you can go to Maco. The tracks are grown over now because they don't use them anymore, but there's a road alongside. And you can check, because you might be the lucky ones to see Joe Baldwin's Maco Light. Thank you. Anybody here from North Carolina where you've heard that story? No? Oh, two people in the back. Yeah, you heard it, right? Yeah, of course you heard it. Yeah.